Rise and Shine Rwanda, it's Wednesday, the 18th of November. Good morning, it's just after 7 o'clock in the morning and you're watching Rise and Shine Rwanda with me, Ivan Magwene.
And me, Yvette Shibusho.
Over the next 1 hour, we'll bring you all the latest news, sports and business headlines from here in Rwanda and around the world. So Yvette, what do you have for us today?
Well, yesterday was the first day at the Africa Global Business Forum. And it's a two-day event. It's ending today. So I'll tell you more about that.
Of course. Shay, what's going on in the world of lifestyle and entertainment?
Well, let's just say that it's very rare to find someone in the gospel industry booming. Mm-hmm. And let's just say Beautiful Ashes is doing big things. More about that to come.
I can't wait to hear. Moses, the world of sports.
A lot is going on, of course. Yesterday, the follow-up at Tour de Rwanda. Guess what? The second stage was taken by a Rwandan. And guess who is that? That guy is called Bintunimana Emil, and he clocked 3 hours, 2 minutes, and 18 seconds. Everyone else was behind him, and more to come in details.
Of course, I can't wait to hear that. Well, all that and more still to come, but first, Rise and Shine, story of the day. And now, as the world marks the International Education Day, we look at the general picture of the reading culture in Rwanda. Let's take a look.
It has been 3 years ever since the Rwanda Library Services was opened in a bid to improve the reading culture in Rwanda. The government has entered several partnerships with various organizations in the interest of promoting reading and innovation. According to the Ministry of Education, the partnerships are in line with the government's vision of creating a knowledge-based economy using technology as the driving force. Lack of reading culture among Rwandans has impacted growth of local publishing industry, even as the government comes up with the programs to boost the sector. With all policies and initiatives implemented by the government and stakeholders, we remain to see if Rwandans can embrace the culture of reading. Ivan Magwene, reporting for Rise and Shine Rwanda.
Chinese philosopher Confucius once said, no matter how busy you may think you are, you must find time for reading or else surrender to self-chosen ignorance. Although this was mentioned centuries ago, it is a clear reflection of what is happening in the country today, despite continuous efforts by the government and other stakeholders. Even with modern platforms such as digital libraries in place, experts believe that the journey of promoting a modeling culture in Rwanda is still far from the finish line. Joining me today is Murangira Ntwari Bruce from iDebate Rwanda to discuss furthermore on this issue. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much.
All right. So first of all, I'd like to say you're looking so sharp today.
Thank you very much. Yes. You're looking sharp yourself.
Thank you so much. Right. So, a very simple question that I'll start with. So far, how many books have you read?
I could really quite count. Okay. There are very many, very, very many. But some of those that I could say are The Date by Dambi Samoyo,
okay.
The Dream Giver by Bruce Wilkinson,
okay.
Novels, French novels, mm-hmm. mostly by Alexandre Dumas, and also Racine.
Okay, quite frankly speaking, that I know many people like to mention I've read Think Big or Gifted Hands, but it's quite a surprise that you never mentioned those kind of books.
I've read those too.
All right, no problem. Okay, we'll get into the questions mm-hmm. furthermore. I want to know, tell us, why do you think that most Rwandans don't have that culture of reading so far?
Allow me to put it into main reasons. Mm-hmm. First of all, we didn't grow with it. Mm. I mean, like in most Western countries, mm. kids of 2 years of age, 3 years of age, they read, their parents read stories to them when going to sleep. Mm. So the kids grow up with a love of storytelling. Mm. But here in Rwanda, a kid doesn't even find a newspaper at home to read. And even at school, the culture isn't promoted at all. So let's say we're learning the language, French language or English language.
Yes.
But you studied the French language and you're not given even an assignment to go and read one book of French and come back to the class and say what you read.
So you think it's all an issue that starts from childhood? The setting in your childhood really affects your
nature? Yeah, really. The environment, the whole environment, whether at home, whether at school, whether in the society, isn't really conducive to us growing to love the spirit of reading. Mm. And another point is there is really no incentive. What do I mean by this? I mean that the culture of reading goes in hand with the culture of writing. And there is really no material. There is no material. So when you don't find the material to read, you don't read at all. And I think this is caused by three main reasons. Mm-hmm. The first reason being that there is no really new material. There is no creativity. Like the most literary works in Rwanda are geared towards our history, specifically the genocide history. Mm. It isn't a bad thing. It's a very good thing to let the world know what happened and why it happened. But it's been 20 years, and in 20 years, so much more has happened. Mm. And I think instead of continuing to show the image of genocide, we should be talking about what Rwanda has achieved so far, and even delve into other things, write romance, write action thrillers, write anything else, mm. but have material. Secondly, people who are creative shy away from writing. Mm. I mean, seriously, we have amazing poets in Rwanda. We have amazing poets. We have I like to read a lot, and many Rwandans are now using blogs, mm. and the material on there is awesome. Mm. But no one is taking it upon him to compile his works, to go to a publishing house and say,
maybe. Here, do you think the same question? I wanted to come exactly to that same issue, because of the background. Maybe do you think also publishing houses out there don't really give a lot of choice or matter to this kind of issue?
Yeah, seriously. So yeah, like in Rwanda, we have we don't even have more than 7 publishing mm. houses, mm. and most of those are houses that publish scholarly material, mm. material to use in classes, to use in schools, and you can't go there with a novel, mm. with the script of a novel there. Mm. No, you have to have had the research, you have had prepared a book that will be used in class, and that's also a problem. We have so few publishing houses that don't even that aren't even conducive to us nurturing mm. our creative spirit mm. as writers.
So my question now goes to, at this moment, Rwanda is targeting to be a knowledge-based economy. Yeah. Mm. And looking at the way things are, if you compare Rwanda to other countries, like in Uganda, or if you go out to Kenya, you find that people have had a broader way of the reading culture.
Yeah.
Do you think maybe our history also has determined the reading culture in Rwanda? Because I'm talking about these countries were countries that had a colonial history by the British, mm-hmm. and this country had the colonial history by the Belgium. Do you think in any way or the other history has determined the reading fate of Rwandans?
Yeah, seriously, yeah. As in most countries that were colonized by the British Empire, mm. they do have a really good culture of reading, mm. which is quite in contrast with countries that were colonized by the Belgian, not the French. Because even in when you go to Western countries that were colonized by the French, like Guinea, Senegal, they have really amazing writers. Mm. But Burundi, Rwanda, and DR Congo, it's a totally different history. So I think, yeah, the history has had a part in it, but also we let the history define for us what we should be doing.
Bruce, let me put you on the spot right now.
Yeah.
At this moment, this is the 21st century, and there's no one to give the excuses. Mm-hmm. Who do you think we should blame this problem? The government, the parents, or the students?
I think mostly we can't blame the parents when they grow up in that with that mindset. It's really a hard thing to change the mindset of someone who is already a grown-up person who has created a comfort zone, a bubble in which he lives. Mm. So mainly, I think who is to blame is the education system. Mm. I mean, yeah, right now things are being changed. Very great steps have been taken, like the introduction of the Kigali Public Library and all. But I think the main reason for Rwandans not having a good culture of reading, especially the youth, is that the education system didn't allow them to be good readers.
All right, thank you so much for coming out to the show. I'm pretty sure this debate can move on.
It can.
And of course, as you said, the education system, a lot of debate has been going on. We can have more discussion on that. Thank you for making out your time to come to the show.
Thank you for inviting me.
All right, you've been watching Rise and Shine Rwanda. We'll be right back after the break.
It's unbelievable, but what you see is what you pay.
Let's get today's business. Yvette Shungusho has the details.
A brand of Rwandan chili Akabanga has been given an international trademark certification, paving the way for better sales in the future. Louise Kayonga, Rwanda Development Board Registrar General, stated that it is a clear manifestation of the possibility that the Rwanda products have to be registered as international brand names. Enterprise Urwibutso registered the Akabanga brand name, obtaining local protection, which have successfully earned the firm a global trademark registration. Urwibutso considered to either use the national route and secure the brand separately in each country, or use the Madrid system that is more efficient and inexpensive. The Africa Global Business Forum 2015 began yesterday at Atlantis, the Palm in Dubai.
The forum was attended by many heads of state, including His Excellency Paul Kagame. The two-day forum is themed New Drivers, New Partners. Yesterday, one of the discussion topics were next steps, cementing gains and enabling the future. His Excellency Paul Kagame was joined by His Excellency Hassan Sheikh Mohamud, President of Somalia, and His Excellency Mohamed Al-Shaibani, Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer of Investment Operations Corporations of Dubai. The human resource HR management function is undermined in many institutions, claiming it adds nothing to organizations. However, with a fast-changing work environment and work dynamics, firms that still have such a kind of thinking could be missing an opportunity to achieve overall growth that should come with a satisfied workforce. A number of HR experts, practitioners, and CEOs interviewed by Business Times related HR function to an engine that drives every organization's growth, saying a company devoid of effective HR management is devoid of development. You are up to date with today's business headlines. Sports news coming in just a minute with Moses Virikunzira.
Welcome back to Rise and Shine Rwanda. Time now for your sports news. I'm Moses Birikunzira. Starting with local cycling, Ferwasi to organize training camp for junior riders. Rwanda Cycling Federation and Team Rwanda Cycling will organize a two-week training camp for junior riders from December 7 to 20th at Africa Rising Cycling Center in Msanze. In a bid to continue nurturing budding talent, the top two juniors riders from each of the top five clubs affiliated to Rwanda Cycling Federation, including Benediction CCA, Ciné Elmay, Fry Cycling Club and Les Amis Sportifs, will be trained by Belgian expert Simon Hupeles, This will be the first training camp for junior riders aged between 15 and 18 years. Onto the region of football. BBC African Football of the Year voting is open as shortlist was named. The five candidates for 2015 BBC African Football of the Year have been revealed during special live launch broadcast in Johannesburg, South Africa. Algeria's Yacine Belhaini, the 2014 winner, is on the shortlist, along with Gabon's Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang and Ghanaian André Ayew and Senegalese Sadio Mane and Yaya Toure of Ivory Coast. The winner will be decided by African football fans who have until 6 o'clock GMT on 30th of November to vote for their choice. And on to international football. Republic of Ireland qualified for Euro 2016 on Monday. The Republic of Ireland secured Euro 2016 spot as two goals from Jonathan Walters helped them overcome Bosnia Herzegovina in the playoff second leg in Dublin. That put the Irish 2-1 up on aggregate, and the win was all about secured when Walters volleyed in on 78th minute. Ireland's win came 6 years after Thierry Henry's infamous handball denied the Irish a place on 2010 World Cup. Elsewhere, Belgium have been forced to call off Tuesday's friendly win with Spain due to security fears. The game was due to be played at the Stade Roi Baudouin in Brussels, but decision was made late on Monday to call the game off on advice of the government.
And of course, again, our Team Rwanda boys are showing us that they can do this. So, quite a win. I didn't expect that to come from Emil. I mean, looking at all the other guys, how more experienced they are. What do you think? Is this showing you that everyone on the team has potential to make it into the Rwanda?
Yeah, this 2D Rwanda, as we were talking about yesterday, this 2D Rwanda is specially made for these young guys of Rwanda because, you know, Rwandans, they are much ready for this 2D Rwanda than they've ever been in recent years because they played a lot of tournaments.
I mean, I've gotten a lot of surprises because at least if you look at the list of Team Muhabura, Team Kalisimbi, there's a lot of people who have not been on the map are getting up and taking over the Valences and all, everyone that people knew. Abraham Rumuliza has not yet shined, but all these young guys are taking up. I don't know. It's full of surprises.
Yeah, one way or another, it's not a surprise because the way these guys are playing, the way Jonathan Boyd, the coach of the cycling team, the way he's telling them, it's a more of tactical than individual playing because it's a team game. Mm. So they decided who they are going to help for a certain stage. You see, the first prologue, it was an individual prologue, and Jean Bosco won it. On Monday, they played again, but Bintuni Mana was in the first three who finished. Mm. And again, this time around, he showed everybody that when the team supports him, for when it's a climbing, because it's more of hills, and there, for him, he's more than ready to take the stage, and he showed it. You know, and the fact that the yellow jersey stays with the Rwandans, you know, Jean Bosco is still the leader overall with 5 hours and 56 seconds, and you know, and me 5 hours 56 minutes and 48 seconds. So, you know, it shows that Rwandans are very much ready this time around to win this tour in Rwanda.
Yes. So as we go on, of course, now I want you to elaborate to us. So now they'll be moving on to Rubavu, and then also they'll be moving, another set will be coming back from Rubavu, from Kigali to Kigali. Those are quite kilometers to cover before this set ends. Well, at this moment, why is it that I'm not seeing Valens come up in the shining? Are we waiting for him to go to Rubavu? Maybe he's more used to the mountains there or something else?
As I said, Valens is a targeted man, you know, because he is the defending champion. And, you know, a targeted person, you know, the arrows know where is he, how can we cover him up.
Okay.
And as I said, it's a more of tactical. You know, when these guys are coming and they expect Valens to win, but the technical team have decided that we might put Valens there to cover all the boys. Someone come from behind to win instead of him winning. Mm. Because at the end of the day, it's an individual. It's a teamwork. It's not individual. It could be good for Valens to win, but the tactical approach of this tour is for someone else without who is not Valens or Hadji Janvier, of whom everybody knows, can come from behind and win. That's why we saw Jean Bosco. That's why we saw Emil coming up. And we expect more to come, even These guys can win one state or two or three, but the overall winner still becomes someone else.
Of course. And now, of course, I can't finish this show without talking about the list is already out. We've seen the BBC Player of the Year, so I can't wait to see who's. Who do you think will take this year? Do you think Yaya will take it this time, or you think Andrew or anyone else has? Aubameyang has the chance also to take it this time on.
This time around, I fancy Aubameyang to take it. Why? Aubameyang, the beginning of this Bundesliga has been, he has been terrific.
How many goals so far?
So far, he has more than, he has more than 20 goals so far. You know, he showed that since the beginning of October, he scored actually more than 8 games in a row, scoring on daily basis. You know, in the Bundesliga, him and Robert Lewandowski, they've been the prolific strikers everyone can imagine. And of course, Yaya Toure, you know, it's a calendar year. It's not just the beginning of a certain season. Yaya Toure won the African Cup of Nations in February, beating Ghana in final. Ayoudédé was beaten. And again, Ayoudédé, coming from France to England, you've seen the first game, the first game of the league in England when Swansea beat Chelsea. You saw the goal he scored, and he was the player of the month of October after scoring 5 goals in that month. And Yaya Toure, I mean, Andre Ayew is standing a chance, but not forgetting Yassin Blahini, who is the current, the defending champion. He won it last year. And in Porto, when the way he's playing in Champions League, that guy, you know, he's only 25 years. And you can't really imagine the way he's playing. He's really awesome to watch. And again, coming up to our man, Sadio Mane of Southampton, that guy is terrific. He scored a hat-trick in 176 seconds. How many minutes are those? I mean, about 2 minutes and some seconds. The fastest hat-trick in history of the world. And Yaya Toure, again, he's the dynamic in the Manchester City midfield, and he's very good. He gives good passes. You can see the way. The reason why Man City is joining top with Arsenal in Premier League at the moment is because of Yaya Toure coming up. You know, last season he was accused because of match fitness and stuff. But this time around, he's more fit and more ready to challenge these guys. But Aubameyang and Sadio Mane, they're up for grabs.
So yeah, those are the two contestants.
Those are the guys I fancy to win this BBC. Right. And you can vote yourself also. So everybody is ready to vote.
All right, thank you so much. There you had it from the world of sports. We'll be right back after the break.
It's unbelievable, but what you see is what you pay.
Let's take a look now at news-making headlines in Rwanda and around the world.
Rwanda will not relent in its push to host the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda at the ICTR Genocide Archives when the court closes. Senior ICTR officials met with Rwandan judicial leaders in Kigali ahead of the official court closure after 20 years of adjudication. In their discussion, it was clear that unresolved concerns by Rwanda would dent the legacy of ICTR, although officials say 80% of the court's mandate was achieved. The court, which is supposed to wind up by December 31st, will be replaced by the residual mechanism for International Criminal Tribunal. Rwanda and the tribunal, established in 1995, have disagreed over several issues, including lengthy but minimal trials, refusal to transfer archives of the court to Rwanda, and breach of sentence enforcement of convicts.
The prospects of an extradition treaty between Rwanda and Zambia appear to be strong. Fulata Lilian Siwinyi, the Zambian Director of Public Prosecution Authority. Siwinyi and a delegation of other Zambian officials of the justice sector have been in Rwanda for the past 3 days on a reciprocal tour seeking to learn from Rwanda's experience on safety of crime witnesses. Although tracking of genocide suspect was not top on the Rwanda agenda, Rwanda's Prosecutor General Richard Muhumuza said that there was a brief discussion on the history of the genocide in which he reiterated Rwanda's wish to have genocide suspects in Zambia extradited. Muhumuza said Zambia is one of the southern African states that have been very cooperative on matters of genocide fugitives, while the rest are still reluctant.
And in regional news, the latest known Ebola patient in Guinea has recovered and been released from a treatment center in the capital, Conakry. A spokesman for Guinea's Ebola coordination unit said 2 tests on the patient, a baby, had been negative. Guinea will be declared officially free of Ebola if no new cases are reported in the next 6 weeks. The epidemic, which began in Guinea, has killed more than 11,000 people in West Africa. Neighboring Sierra Leone and Liberia have already been declared Ebola-free by the World Health Organization earlier this month after 42 days without a single declared case. Liberia was declared free of the disease in September.
The African Union's Peace and Security Council recommended the organization plans for sending troops to Burundi if violence in the Central African nation worsens and called for investigation into rights abuses there. Burundi has suffered months of violent turmoil since President Pierre Nkurunziza announced in April he would seek a third term, a move that triggered protests and a failed coup. The opposition said the president's decision violated constitution and a peace deal that ended a civil war in 2005. Nkurunziza won the July 21st election that was boycotted by his opponents. In recent weeks, Burundi has seen increased shooting and grenade attacks targeting top government officials and members of the opposition. And in international news, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry has described Islamic State IS militants as psychopathic monsters following Friday's deadly attacks in Paris. Mr. Kerry in Paris for talks with President Hollande, and he said that the U.S. stood shoulder to shoulder with France. Mr. Hollande says France is committed to destroying IS. French airstrikes hit the militants in Syria overnight. IS has said it carried out the attacks on bars, restaurants, a concert hall, and a stadium, in which 129 people died. A huge manhunt is still underway for the suspected member of a group, Sahar Absalam, who was believed to have fled across the border in his native Belgium.
Okay, lots more still to come. We take a look at lifestyle and what's hot right now in our daily debate section, Hot Topics with Sherry Uwase. We'll be right back.
Welcome to Lifestyle. I am Sherry Uwase. Let's take a look at the world of the gospel industry in Rwanda. The famous band Beautiful Ashes had a tour in Kenya, which was concluded by a performance and appearance at Kenya's popular show, The Churchill Show. Take a look.
No matter how life can get hard, it never leaves me when I'm sad. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, let's appreciate Beautiful Ashes. You have Beautiful Ashes. You have an amazing story. Do you want to share with us, Oliver, how you started, especially after the aftermath of what happened in Rwanda?
Many of you know what happened in Rwanda 21 years ago. The genocide came and devastated everyone. And myself, I'm a genocide survivor. I was only 9 years old by then. And after the genocide, I was really bitter. I was angry. And all I needed to do was was seeking revenge. You know, people who killed my family, people who killed my parents. And happened to meet this man called Jesus. I gave him my life, and then in exchange, he gave me this spirit of forgiveness, and I started writing songs. When I started writing songs, quickly they became a therapy for me. And after those songs becoming, like, I was totally healed. And then after being healed, I felt like God calling me to stay. Same songs that you've been healed through, I'm going to use them to heal many people in the nations, and that's what he's doing.
A band. It's made up of a few guys. I think that three or four, mm-hmm. and one lady.
Okay.
Yeah, I think she is from Korea or Philippines. Oh. I'm not so sure. So
are they Rwandans?
Yeah, they are Rwandans. The rest of them are Rwandans. Yes, yes,
okay.
And they're very good. I think they come from CLA, Christian Life Assemblies.
I know that church.
You know that because you
go there.
Shout out. Yeah, so they come from that church and they're very good. They've actually been coming up, so they've been in Kenya for the past, I think, from the beginning of this mid last month.
Okay.
Yeah, last month they've been there. They've been doing some church tours and even school tours. So they were actually supposed to come already. But then Churchill, I don't know if you know the Churchill
show. Yes, I know
Churchill. Very,
yes,
very
Kenya,
big show in Kenya.
Mm.
So they asked them if they could be on the show, if they could host them on the show. So they had to stay back a bit because it's a big deal.
It's a very big deal.
It's
Churchill
deal.
Is watched by
yeah.
nearly the 44 million
yeah,
Kenyans
I know, right?
in Kenya.
Yes, and even out of Kenya because,
yes, because
it
now we
promotes
have citizen.
Comedy and mm. all that. So it's a big show. So they went for that and... let me just say, it was amazing. As you've seen in the VT, it was amazing.
Definitely.
And, you know,
and they're really good, too.
They're very good. They're very good. And Kavute, who is the founder of the band, Olivier, he shared his story of how he started doing gospel music and his journey and how it was a therapy for him after what happened to him, I think, after the genocide and all that, because he's a survivor. So he shared this story, and he said this music was sort of like a therapy to him, and I was like, why don't I just share it with the rest of the world? So it's a very good thing, and let me just say they're really good. If you haven't attended their concerts, if you haven't attended their concerts, you need to go. You need to catch the next concert.
What do you think this means for the gospel industry?
Actually, this almost brings us to what we're going to talk about in our hot topic. But let me just say it is really coming up. When you try to compare it to what's happening in Kenya, definitely they're far much ahead. But as Rwandans and as the gospel industry, I think the future is really bright.
Very.
Very bright.
Alrighty, thank you.
So, thank you, and we'll be right back after the break. Rwanda will not relent in its push to host the International Criminal Court Tribunal for Rwanda ICTR. Genocide archives even when the court closes. Senior ICTR officials met with Rwanda judicial leaders in Kigali ahead of the official court closure after 20 years of adjudication. In the discussions, it was clear that unresolved concerns by Rwanda would dent the legacy of ICTR, although officials say 80% of the court's mandate was achieved.
Now, I think you spoke about this in the story that you did,
yeah, in the news. And let's just say that this is very puzzling for me, you know, because this is something that has been on for the past 20 years, the ICTR, and it's been trying to, you know, to deal with all this the post-genocide effects and dealing with the people who took part in this. And just the fact that, you know, it has to come to an end and they have to close that and hand it over to the international court is, I don't know what you guys feel about that, but let me just begin with you because I know you have so much to say.
Well, I would say this is, we are going to have this discussion, I think, I will just represent my opinions, but
right.
It's a deep analysis. We can have it on the other side of the ICTR, also on the government side.
Mm.
But as a Rwandan, for example, why do they always say that the ICTR hasn't really done a commendable job? First of all, 20 years on the road, it has not solved some of the biggest cases that we have seen. Some genocide fugitives are still on the hunt, and some of them have not been brought to justice.
Mm.
And even the scandal that went on last week, but one when one of the journalists went on to interview Kambanda in a prison in Mali, Bamako, he even got a chance to deny the genocide.
Yeah.
I mean, he's been sentenced to all those years in prison, and then he has all the access, which again, I don't want to debate about.
Yeah.
But now the question is, now that the court has come to an end,
right.
Then what?
Right.
All these big guys that had a very big contribution to the genocide are still out there, still enjoying their lives in Europe and all those countries,
right.
And some of them have made tremendous lives out in Europe, but what then
for
the people out here that are still looking for justice? Not forgetting that the reason why Rwanda sees this as a failure is because, first of all, a lot of money was spent on these cases.
Very much.
A lot of money, billions and millions of dollars were spent on these cases.
True.
And at the end of the day, some of the cases and trials were taking almost like 4 years to even get a conclusion, 6 years, 7 years. I understand justice has to be delivered, but then at what price? It's another question.
Mm.
And lastly, I would say we did a very good job in terms of the Gachacha courts. We had thousands and thousands of trials to do here. But we were able to do, with the resources, the limited resources the government had, they had to do that.
But when
we compare it to the ICTR, it was really hard.
Yes.
But then, for me, the biggest question right now is not even the ICTR. It has done what it has done. They think they've done the 80% of the job. They need to represent that. But the question is then, after that, what? Because all these guys are still on the hunt, and we need them to see them put to justice and people get justice for themselves.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
First thing I want to be able to ask, let me clear something.
Mm-hmm.
Help me clear something, actually.
Yes. When the ICTR is closed, yes, they closed recently.
They're going to close on the 31st
of
December.
On the 31st of December.
Yes.
Okay, great.
End of this year.
If, unless I'm wrong, but I read somewhere that these cases were being taken to the International Tribunal.
Yes, that's
they're
right.
They're now going to be taken
to the Hague.
They're going
to
be
to the Hague.
They're going to be handed over to them.
Yes.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So when you ask something like, what now? I answer, they're going to be taken to the International Court.
Yes.
Well,
yes?
The thing is, they're going to create another commission where they're going to handle those cases.
Exactly.
But then the problem is, what the court was designed to do was never accomplished.
Yes, but
which is just an opinion.
Yes. Now, what I'm trying to answer your question is that something is going to be done. They're going to be taken to the International Criminal Court, and they're going to be dealt with there, where they're going to organize another association that is going to deal with those courts. So yes, these fugitives that are out there are going to be dealt with. Justice is going to be brought to the people of Rwanda.
But Sherry, I have another question. Okay. It's been 20 years after the genocide, right? Right? Uh-huh. And 20 years after the genocide, fugitives are still on the run. And now, she's saying these cases are going to be handed over to the International Criminal Court,
right?
But then it's been 20 years. 20 years, some people have already even given up in terms of justice. Yet this court was established to carry out the same cases to make sure that these people are brought to justice on time. Remember, even justice that is not delivered on time is failed justice.
But don't
justice
you think
needs to be delivered on time. 20 years after this,
yes,
this has not yet been done.
And that's why this ICTR is being closed down and these cases are being taken to the international court so they can be dealt with in due time.
It has not closed down because they need to take it to the Hague. It has closed down because it has done its work.
No, it hasn't.
You know what? Let me finish before we keep the conversation to this side. Allow me to have Moses. What do you think?
Thank you. For me, there is always a big question.
Right.
When it comes to justice to Rwandans, to people who suffered, people who lost their lives.
Right.
And people who did that to millions of Rwandans are still outside enjoying their lives. And they are there denying what they have done. And people, when you mention the International Criminal Court, there for me, there's always a question mark. Is the International Criminal Court there to solve problems or they are there to create problems? So there are some of the problems that they create. I mean, there are some of the cases that they take to International Criminal Court. There's no results because the areas there for Africa.
So it's closed forever. That's what Moses is saying.
I mean,
there are no results at all.
To me, that's why they say they're not going to rely on the archives of ICTR because they don't believe that there's something left behind that is going to bring justice afterwards.
So it's more like let's take it over, but in real sense, there is nothing to take over.
Kind of stuff. It's like that.
I mean,
if Rwandans, if Gacaca solved millions, I mean, so many cases, and ICTR say we solved only 80%, and the biggest cases, you see, so many people outside enjoying their lives, and they were not dealt with, and you say you are taken to ICTR. I mean, to International Criminal Court.
Okay.
On which purpose? Is it because you failed to achieve your goals, or is it because they are more superior to what you could offer? Or, I mean, there's always a question mark, why didn't you complete your work to an extent you send it to ICTR? I mean, to International Criminal Court, whereby we're also not sure whether they will deliver as per as per Rwandans really want justice to be solved.
Okay.
Yes.
Let me just have you finish before we move into the next thing. Yes.
First of all, no, wait, yes. Ivan. No. I have to say this. Okay. First of all, Moses, I think they're not looking at the archives of ICTR because they want to start afresh. I think that is one point. A second, I believe that ICTR is being closed down. Yes, because it has finished its work. It's been 20 years. But also think about this. They have not been able to achieve that other 20% of what they were supposed to do. Why? We do not know for sure. So they're handing it to another criminal court to see if this can actually work.
Because they have enough resources.
Yes. Another thing which I feel is not correct is handing it over to the international court. Why? Because they're not close to this case. I believe they will probably not even put as much effort to it because the people of Rwanda took care of these cases because these were personal to them. I mean, okay, it's a good and bad thing. Personal, you might not do the right thing. It might be too much. Or personal, you might put everything you have in order to clear this. International Criminal Court has literally so many cases all over the world. I mean, who says that they're actually really going to focus on Rwanda on those fugitives they've not been able to get for the past 21 years.
All right.
Honestly.
Yes, you have something burning.
Finally. This is the whole thing. Okay. At the end of the day, this is for the best interest for people in this country to get justice.
Okay.
And if justice has been delayed for people in this country, that means justice is being denied for people in this country.
Absolutely.
The ICTR is closing down after 20 years. Mm-hmm. 20 years with billions and millions of US dollars mm-hmm. to take down all these cases. Mm-hmm. Transferring different cases to different countries is not the problem to solve this issue.
Yes.
Rather, we should have seen the best way in interest for the Rwandan people and the Rwandan people that needs to get the justice mm-hmm. come to a conclusion that even after the closure, at least these cases should be brought closer to the Rwandan people
yeah.
instead of being taken further from the Rwandan people. Because mm-hmm. at the end of the day, we understand the conflict. I think we understand better the justice. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much.
Okay, yeah. He's a very good debater. He's been winning all these prizes.
I think we should invite somebody from justice to come up and tell us.
Yeah, the ICTR.
Why don't we bring some of the people in the international court to come to Rwanda mm-hmm. and try to deal with these cases instead of shutting down our system and taking it to them?
We're not so sure. Maybe that has been done before. We're not
well,
so sure
I
about
that.
Well,
I did read something about that. But still, okay. I mean, we should emphasize it.
Anyway, everyone has so many, very many sentiments about this. So we'll just leave it at that. Now, Russia's security chief says it is the one that brought down the Russian plane in Egypt, killing almost 224 people on board. The breaking news story is being updated and more details will be coming up soon. So I think we're all aware about the Russian plane that came down just recently. And, there was a lot of investigation going on, yes, in Egypt. And now they have just found out that it was actually a terror attack. That's the only news that we know for now. It was just a terror attack. But who would have thought that it was a terror attack?
I mean, I'm thinking, is it really a terror attack? And how is it that they've just known a few days after the Paris attack, which then was a terror attack? I'm not sure about that, but yeah, please answer that for me.
All right. As you already know, a few weeks back, the plane was brought down. What did this mean? Of course, they couldn't say it was a terror attack before the investigation went on.
Yes.
Because
right.
Americans already had a report and the British that this was a terror attack. Uh-huh. A bomb was put on the plane that was flying.
Plane. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Okay.
Yes.
Great.
So Americans, the American investigations and the American intelligence and the UK intelligence came to clear that this was a terror attack. But the Egyptians and the Egyptian president came out to say this was not a terror attack until the investigation clearly showed that this was
a terror attack. Yes.
And Russians had to play their part. The Egyptians to play their part. And at the end of the day, if the report comes out that this was a terror attack, indeed this might have been a terror attack because it didn't have a clear explanation of how a plane took off from the ground, reached the sky, and from nowhere it went bump. It split off. So this shows that what does this mean for Egypt now that this has been declared a terror attack? It is a terror attack because the plane was passing through the Sinai, and the Sinai is also close to Syria.
Yes,
so that means ISIS could have had access. Very easy access. And even after the plane went down, ISIS claimed that it was a terror attack by the ISIS, which shows you that ISIS has now become a global threat. And it is a global threat, not only for any kind of country, but it has become a global threat for Egypt, for any country within the region. So, and this leaves the question on whether, of course, now countries are going to start looking at Egypt and making sure that now this is going to be a no-fly zone, which at the end of the day is going to affect
the economy
of Egypt.
And
so, for me, well, this was a terror attack, and this leaves the question, it's not who to blame, but now if the investigation shows us that it is a terror attack, that means ISIS is a global threat. It is on the move, and the world needs to work together to make sure that this comes down to peace.
That's a story for another day, which is also true. I really agree. It's becoming a very big threat. Moses, what do you think?
To me, America is coming back to ISIS. You know, these terrorists, they have intimidated the entire world, and coming to Africa now, in Egypt, it shows that worldwide, all the nations, all the powerful nations in the world should gather together and find
attend
the best
to this.
For the people. Mm. Because this is, many people are dying for this. And, it's people's lives that are going.
Mm.
And they should, it should be a global threat, as he mentioned, and they should start acting. You know, France has started acting, partnering with Americans and the British, of course.
Mm.
It should be very much addressed because this ISIS, they are they are acting everywhere, everywhere in the world. It should be something addressed as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Otherwise, the world.
Yeah, can I say something?
They would like to declare the third world.
Yes.
Third world war.
We should not only look at ISIS. We also have to look at common problems that we have around with the Al Shabaab. When most people see Al Shabaab and Al Qaeda and everything and Boko Haram in Nigeria, when we look at all these global threats, we normally tend to look at them as they are so far away from us that we know. But Kenya is just a few hours away from us.
An hour away from us.
And then when it's affected. And you've seen that when Kenya is affected in one way or the other, we're affected so bad. So we need to work together on this issue of terrorism. Terrorism is ruining the world in terms of humanity, in terms of peace, in terms of the economy. So I think it's a global issue. And then I think the global, globally, we should come together to address this issue. That's my opinion.
Okay. And I think everyone would really agree because, you know, it's affecting anyone. You know, who would have thought that somebody would bomb Paris or,
of course,
you know, any other country in
Those
Africa.
People are very courageous.
Yeah,
I don't know how they even did it.
It's you know, we just have to be on guard because you don't know, it might be our country next, God forbid, or just our neighboring country, you know.
But I think we have an idea of the countries they are targeting.
Well,
the superpowers.
Yeah, the superpowers, but not just the ISIS, but we also have other terrorism groups.
Yes, there's Al Shabaab.
Yeah, none of us. We have the Boko Haram, we have the Al Qaeda, we have the Al Shabaab.
I was talking specifically about ISIS.
Yeah. And now, on Sunday, the 15th of November 2015, Groove Awards was held. Groove Awards is the performance awards given to the gospel music industry. In East Africa, and now it happened in Rwanda. Now, many nominees were given different categories, which include Male Artist of the Year, Female Artist of the Year, Choir of the Year, Video of the Year, Song of the Year, Worship Song of the Year, or Hip Hop Song of the Year, New Artist of the Year, Dance Group of the Year, Radio Show of the Year, Radio Presenter of the Year, and many other things. And many nominees, the nominees included Israel Mbonye, Diana Kamugisha, Gloria Gogo, Tonzi, Allah Ministries, and many others. So let me just tell you guys that the groups and the people, the individuals that were nominated for this Groove Awards, the Gospel Music Awards, it wasn't anybody who is already famous. You can talk of Passion, you can talk of Gabi, you can talk of none of those was nominated, actually. It's just everybody that's new to the industry. So to me, I feel like, you guys know how I have the special attachment to gospel music. So I just felt like, wow, this is a beautiful thing. You know, they're recognizing new talent, and that's really something that everybody should be doing. Moses, what do you think?
It is. When you go to gospel, I mean, it brings us close to God, and we are all created by God. And
right.
These ladies and gentlemen out there who are really bring that attachment, that emotional connection to the God should be recognized, because when you see other music, other music in Rwanda and around the world being recognized, I mean, for gospel it should be also a special case, because that's why some people don't really take consider gospel as something very important, because
right.
without God you cannot achieve anything.
True.
And the fact that they've recognized new upcoming artists is also another step up, and they should keep it up. And also, we see some of the gospel singers and artists also move all the way to the global level.
Okay, good, Yvette.
I mean, when I think about the newbies in the industry getting nominated and not the older people. Oh, not all the people.
Actually,
the people
not because they were favoring them,
not
because they were doing that, but just because they actually fitted the criteria.
That just makes me think, or at least, yes, actually makes me think, you know what, I think maybe the people that have been in the industry for longer should actually take note of what the newbies are doing right now and what they're doing in music, so that they can learn from it. Because they're probably bringing something that is different, something that's unique. And so they should also take that into consideration so that they can actually have better music and actually be nominated next time.
Okay. Well, Sherry, I will have to say, as a person that is in the gospel industry, I think
you are?
No, she loves the gospel industry. I think I'm very happy that the gospel industry in Rwanda is really growing.
It's picking up.
Of course.
Right.
And then the other issue is like, if you see, for example, Israel Mbonye, Gogo, all these young people have very good voices, they have good music.
Mm.
I think you've seen Pasia has been doing a very good job.
He
and I also want to recommend people like Moria Entertainment has been doing a very good job in making sure that they produce very quality videos.
Yeah,
it was very hard to find quality videos for the the gospel music in Rwanda. But every Sunday when I tune into my to TV, I always watch quality videos, and I'm very happy because at least at the end of the day, gospel music in this country is picking up, and it's very good. We should praise the Lord and praise the Lord in style and in clear visions and clear pictures. Of
and you know, quality, yeah. Quality is everything. You know, yes. Even as any other, you know, industry is growing. We still also want the ministry of God to grow in the right direction.
Should grow fast, in fact.
Yeah, it will, and it's going to be like that.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
Don't forget, we love to hear your thoughts, comments, and feedback on what we're talking about here on Rise and Shine Rwanda. Tweet us at Rise and Shine RW. Like us on Facebook and send us your ideas for programs. Check out our Rise and Shine Rwanda YouTube page where you can catch all the shows and reports we do. Find us on Instagram, Rise and Shine RW. We love to see your pictures. Or check out our Rise and Shine Rwanda website, www.riseandshinerwanda.com. Well, that is all the time we have for you today. We love to hear your feedback, and do let us know if you have any ideas for programs. You have been watching Rise and Shine Rwanda with me, Yvette Shumbusho.
And me, Ivan Magwenya. We'll be at same time, same place tomorrow. Do join us then. But for now, from the both of us and the rest of the Rise and Shine team, have a very good day. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.